Hey up, dickheads, how's it going, like? How's it going, dickheads?
That's what I'm gonna call people who view my videos. If you view my video, you're a fucking dickhead, mate. It's kind of like how PewDiePie calls his bro army, or Game Grumps calls their fans the lovelies. You know, it's a thing that people with a large following of audiences. I don't want to say fans, I want to say following, because being a fan being short for fanatic, is, I would say the inappropriate word, because you can follow something without being a fan of it, but if you follow something like this, you're a fucking dickhead, mate! So, going forwards, I've got some stuff to go over that's absolutely fucking nuts. These are cashew nuts. They're really good for you, by the way. I also have almonds. I've been buying these because, you know, nuts are really expensive, but the health benefits of, like, almonds and cashews are worth the price. This packet cost me about £2.40. I think the cashews cost £2.30, or the other way around. It doesn't matter. 200 grams of nuts in each one. You know, it's the best value I could find up in Tesco. Like, gotta sell some bananas as well. They're a little bit green at the moment, doesn't matter, I ate one earlier. Gave me a lot of energy, got me buzzing, you know, got me talking really fast, thinking in a positive mood off the potassium, the glucose and stuff. That wasn't enough glucose, so I decided to move back onto the Lucozade. You know, I like drinking Lucozade, it gives me a lot of energy and makes me talk really fast. Same with coffee, I drank a cup of coffee just before doing the video. I started making the video, but then I just needed to go take a shit because I drank a cup of coffee, and then I started drinking this afterwards because I was realizing that I was just running out of energy and I couldn't really continue up with the moat of thinking that I was trying to achieve with that. Also, when you talk really fast like this, what I'm doing now, it's very easy to do. I'm not reading from anything, I'm just talking as fast as I possibly can. But the biggest problem is you always run out of words to say, and you start thinking of, like, if I pause for too long, it just kills the rhythm of what I'm trying to say. It doesn't seem as if you're actually saying anything that's relevant at all, but even though it is, it's hard to comprehend. And you need to put the pauses in, give people time to think. You know, people are more likely to take on board if they guess what you're about to say. You know, if you put in that little bit of pause where they think, why did he not say it soon enough? And you start to think, it really fucks with your mind. That's something I've learned. I studied a lot of psychology. When I say studied, I mean, I didn't really study anything. I've not studied anything. Even though I've been in fucking university for fucking 3 years, I don't feel like I've studied anything. All I've done is got more experience with stuff in life. So today in this episode, I'd like to share with you some of the things, and this is really just some of the things that I have been using for my experience. This is on my channel, on my YouTube page. You can see here that I've got, this is a cool channels in a shuffled order, and down here I've got recommended playlists. Now, this is very, very incomplete because I don't know if it shows it anywhere, but in my playlists section, you can see that I've got, like, I've started out trying to make like ASMR playlists, a gameplay of all my stuff, my memes playlists, and my liked videos. My liked videos playlist has fucking 3,442 videos in it. A lot of those have been deleted or removed by this point. But the main ones that I've been working on to bring to you, well, that's my featured channels. The main ones I'm bringing here are the playlist here, the audio one, which is just audio that I don't have on my computer, because I have a lot of audio on my computer. I'll show you this. Like, this is my Music Bee app. Can I bring this down so that it's like it shows the top here? Yeah, there we go. Look, this is Music Bee. It's my media player of choice. I've got, like, fucking shit tons of music in here. Does it say it down here in the bottom section? It does. It tells me that I've got exactly let's bring this up so that it reveals the thing properly, but not too far. There we go. It says down there, 18,630 files, 165 gigabytes, or 59 days. That's in my music section, and then when I go over to my audiobook section, where I've just downloaded audiobook. I paid for audiobooks. I'm not a naughty pirate. Yes, that's 20 days. So I've got 20 days there and 60 days here. But doesn't matter. I put a bunch of stuff on YouTube. This is mostly this audio playlist. Let's see, this isn't going to give you much insight into the world, but it does. I think a lot of the music in here, if you enjoy hearing it, it can elevate your mood to a point where you no longer are distracted by your own negativity. Because you start to think, while you're listening to this music, you know, any negativity that you have is just like, well, it doesn't really matter, the negativity. Or does it? That's something I'm going to get to in a bit. So yeah, buckle your seats. This is mostly a mix of vaporwave, future funk, ambient electronic, and whatever else. And I say whatever else because once it gets past the future funk, the vaporwave, and the synth wave, the just a bunch of wave music, it's just generic electronic music. Got a bunch of different things in here. I would recommend listening to stuff here because you might find something you like. Also, I added memes at the end of here. These are meant to go in the memes folder, but hey, you know, what can I do? I'm a very busy, active person. I can't be constantly doing all of these things. The next one is one that I'm currently working on, which is called Pete's and His Keck. Now, the Pete's and His Keck playlist is primarily the Joe starts out with the Joe Rogan Experience, which is something else I'm going to get to, but it's about Jordan Peterson. Jordan B. Peterson is a professor of psychology. He's very, very knowledgeable and experienced when it comes to understanding and discussing human psychology and human philosophy, which is one of the main things that I'm wanting to try and get my own head around, which is what do we do and why does it matter? You know, this is the biggest questions of being a human being. Once you get past the whole I have water, this isn't water, this is fucking Lucid, and I have food, this is, you know, I have food and water, I've got a bed, you know, I can survive, but beyond that, what do I do? And then, why does it matter what I do? These are very big, fundamental questions that generally, you need to answer those questions to go beyond just surviving. Because if you're just surviving for the sake of it, you can never really feel like what you're doing is right. It just feels wrong. And I want to make it, I want to be in a position where what I'm doing feels right. So that's why I've been studying into this stuff. They say you can't learn from other people why, you can't find from other people what gives your life any kind of meaning or significance. But I'm damn well trying. Jordan Peterson seems to be the closest thing I've found to coming to any kind of conclusions based on that. Another great source of this kind of information, I put in my recommended channels of stuff that this is stuff that I enjoy watching on YouTube most of the time. I don't know, you know, stuff like Ego Raptor, for example, he hasn't made any videos for a long time, so I don't know if I even enjoy it. Robert Benford, his stuff's more comedy. But then you get down here, this is the more intellectually challenging or pseudo-intellectual shit. Not Million Dollar Extreme, that's once again more comedy, but Sam Hyde does actually provide a lot of insight and a lot of very, very critical kind of approaches to things that really do make you think about things if you hadn't already thought about it. Or even if you have, listening to what Sam Hyde says in his Hyde Wars series will probably just give you a little bit of food for thought. I mean, that's what he's trying to do, give people food for thought whilst being entertaining. That's one of the things that a lot of these channels and people end up not doing. Like Jordan Peterson, he's very, very, very dry and he throws a joke in every now and again by accident, but he's not trying to convey himself in an entertaining way. He really wants to really shock people into listening to what he says. Athene, here's another one. A lot of what Athene says and does is very positive. He's in the sort of situation of, what do you do and what does it matter? His approach to that is very, very, very fundamentally based around logic. What do you do? Well, if you're asking yourself that question, take the physics approach and find a logical conclusion on what you do. You break it down into what we are, matter and energy, and then what being a person is, what being alive is. Then you extract from that and say that being alive is important because the logical agreement is that you want to preserve life due to its importance. This is a recurring theme that I see in, like, religious beliefs. So he's trying to reach a religious kind of, we are humans, we are special, you know, this whole kind of, you're trying to give something meaning by saying that it's special and that's why it matters, because it's special. You can find that through a deity, or you can find that through logic, but I don't know, that seems to be what Athene is doing, like giving he's more proactive about giving you a course of action, similarly to what Peterson was doing, and Scott Adams, his YouTube channel doesn't really have a lot of the stuff that he says on it, because prior to this, Scott Adams, I've seen him in interviews with other people. He had his series on Periscope, which is like a live streaming thing that people do from their phone. And he also wrote a blog online, the Dilbert blog, which is very worth checking out. But Scott Adams has started up a YouTube channel. I mean, he's only got 12,000 subscribers, and he hasn't really made that many videos to really go into the insights that I've managed to get from him. I read his book. One of his books, because he's wrote a few books, but the one I read of his was How to Fail at Almost Everything and Still Win Big, because I'm still looking for more kind of, what do I do and why? And fundamentally, for me, I know what I should do, but it's how do I, I know what I think I want out of life, but is that really what I want? And why do I want it? Can I confirm that that's what I want in life? These are the three things that I'm still looking into. Trusting in yourself, that's a big thing, but you can be wrong, and it's okay to be wrong, just I want to not be wrong, which is the big thing that I'm always striving for. Like, wanting to be right is very fundamental when you can be right if you do more research. Like, for example, that's why I end up watching channels like Veritasium, Vsauce, and Kurzgesagt, because these are sciencey channels. These are science entertainment channels that give you a very brief but not deep enough understanding of certain things. They make you feel like you understand something when really you don't, but it's kind of like a basis to at least bring things to your attention. Like, for example, they could talk about different fields of quantum physics and make you think that you understand quantum physics, like multidimensionals, dark matter, dark energy, these kind of things. Make you think that you know a little bit about them. Really, you don't. All you know is the name and the label associated with them. But that's a good starting point. I mean, if they make a video here that tells you the very basics of the, of like, I don't know, something fairly, that seems fairly simple and intuitive, like gravity, and you think, that's obvious, you know, you pick something up, you drop it, it'll fall down. But then there's a lot more going on behind that. Like, how does one thing have influence over the other? Like, how does gravity influence the things that it does? Does it do that with waves? You know, Is it like sucking things to it? You know, how do you actually explain that physically and through language? It's like then you go over to Wikipedia and you look at more specialist analysis of those kind of things. But these are great starting points. Similarly, that's where my inspiration and information playlist comes in, where it briefly it's full of deleted videos because it's like just copyrighted things. The censorship or the hiding of information, I think it's really dumb that the whole point of some of these documentaries and some of these videos that people put up here, they're like, hey, I don't want you sharing this information unless I can make money off of it. This is a very, 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 very fundamental aspect of progressing as a race, is that we need to not hide knowledge and information behind paywalls, which is why the whole idea of university costing so much money is stupid. You say then, well, people can't get people, you know, the university has to make money somehow, it has to be supported somehow. Yes, I understand that, but the way that it's kind of conducted is in like, this information is hidden behind a paywall, you have to pay to learn, or so and such and such a thing. It's like, you either want people to be smart or you want people to be dumb and you want to get money out of them. I don't know. I think there's a fundamental flaw in the way that we approach sharing information. You know, that you have to subscribe and pay money to get certain bits of knowledge, when really it should be just, it should be freely available, because people being smarter, I think, improves the world. Something else I can get to, does being dumb make life better than being smart? Because when you're smarter, you worry more, and they say ignorance is bliss. Is that true? Probably. There's a lot of stuff in here about astrophysics. There's a lot of stuff in here about Elon Musk, SpaceX, and then there's a lot of stuff here about psychology, humans, more physics, more psychology, and just economics. A lot of different topics in here that it's mostly stuff that I've watched and found some kind of inspiration or information from. It's not a very comprehensive or complete list, because as you can imagine, there is tons of shit on YouTube and you can find a lot of it, but if you're really struggling to find things, this is a great starting point. If you're looking to try and find the kind of information that I found, or if you want to know where I got my information from, it's most of these things. You know, channels like Stefan Molyneux for a lot of things. And like I say, you can't just go to one source for information. You have to get varied sources of information. So I'm looking for an equivalent of Stefan Molyneux who can look at a lot of these different topics from a different angle. I looked into a lot of the insight of David Foster Wallace. This is very different. He's more talking about people and society as opposed to the bigger picture of things. There's a lot of stuff that I'm like really skimming over here. There's fucking PewDiePie videos in here because for a time period, PewDiePie was being very insightful. As far as I could tell, I didn't disagree with anything he said, and I found a lot of what he said to be actually helpful and very mindful to know. Let's see, Joe Rogan Experience. Now that's something I want to get to next, and of course the Jordan Peterson stuff. Now, the Joe Rogan Experience. I know what you're saying. Joe Rogan, like, you'll have mixed opinions on him if you've never watched any of his shows, but I watch his podcast because I like to hear the discussions that he has with people who I know or have followed, as well as people who I've never really heard talk before. They seem to get some decent insight into things, especially when it's some certain guests. Like, for example, if he has on Bill Burr is very good at taking apart certain things in life that, and looking at things in a very different way to as you might normally. He's a comedian, and that's what most comedians do. Comedians are, without a doubt, some of the most intelligent people on the planet. They're also some of the most depressed, because I think that the more depressed you get, the more you start to seek, the more you understand about the world, the more you realize things aren't what they seem, and you start to look for more meaning in your life. You start to look at things in very different ways, because it's the only way that you can try and get some kind of meaning out of it. You keep trying to think, well, it can't be just this. It has to be more to it than that. So you start questioning things and start looking at things in different ways. It's what Bill Burr does, and he does that very well. Neil deGrasse Tyson, he has a very good understanding of mathematics, but he's also very good at verbally articulating those things in a way that people can understand, or at least feel like they understand the basics of. You know Neil deGrasse Tyson, I don't need to explain this. Stefan Molyneux again, Louis Theroux, he, in this episode, I don't know which one it is, but in one of them, he kind of just discusses the things that he makes his documentaries about. Louis Theroux is definitely a very well-researched person who looks into a lot of things very, very thoroughly, and his insights are valuable. Michael Stevens from Vsauce, like I said, he's someone else who does a lot of research. Stefan Molyneux does a lot of research. Brian Cox, obviously, I don't need to go on about this. People who do research, people who get lots of life experience, people who have high intelligence, like Sam Harris, think what you will. He contradicts a lot of the things that I look into, but the more contradictions you get, the better picture you get. If it's like looking at a picture from one dimension, and then you see, all right, that's a box. Then you look at it that you see like a picture of a square, and you say, hey, that's just a square. You look at it from another angle, and you can see, well, actually, this is a three-dimensional shape. You know, you see what I mean. You add from two dimensions you're looking at. You look at it from another angle. Now you see it's three dimensions. And you get a better idea of what the box is that you're looking at. So the more perspectives you can look at it from, the better picture you get. This Russell Brand episode was about, you know, once again, people finding within themselves more meaning. And you might dislike Russell Brand. You might dislike Joe Rogan, but it doesn't matter, because it's not about the people, it's about what they're discussing and the discussions that they have. That's why I like this show. Scott Adams, once again, he'll fucking blow your mind. Listen to Scott Adams for any extended period of time, even a short period of time, and your mind will be blown to pieces. Same with Jordan Peterson. Like, this week must have been fucking insane for Joe Rogan. 874 to 877. Straight afterwards, Scott Adams blowing his mind, and then Jordan Peterson blowing his mind, like fucking hell. You know, Alex Jones, this guy, he is without a doubt. I've made a playlist of Alex Jones. This is like unlisted, but you can still access it. The Alex Jones playlist is, this is memes about Alex Jones, because you need to look at the memes to really get a good understanding of how Alex Jones as a character portrays his information. He is undoubtedly some of the most well-researched, and the sources that he gets his information from are undeniably reliable, but he presents them in a way that is entertaining enough that he can create a following of people who laugh at him, but they watch his videos, as opposed to if he was just being serious, you know, if he wasn't screaming and shouting, people wouldn't watch his videos. I completely understand it. Watch more Alex Jones stuff, because it's funny, and most of what he says is right. Most of what he says is right. Now, what else is there on here? Kevin Smith. Well, I just like Kevin Smith, you know, because he's a good director. Bill Burr. Gavin McInnes, he brings another kind of like comedian's perspective onto things, and has just another interesting viewpoint. It's not as deeply insightful, as most of the rest on this list, but it's still entertaining. Philip DeFranco, once again, he brings insight and news. He's another great example of someone who's always well-researched, very fast to respond, very on the ball, brings different opinions to all the other people I follow. So that's Joe Rogan. Pete's in his kek. I explained this already. Pete's in being kek is the fact that he has been said to sound like Kermit the Frog, and at one point in time, someone on 4chan made a post where he had about 6 recurring letters that said Pete's in his kek. And now, if you know anything about the rules of dubs, trips, or quads, you know, you'll know that when you get 6 recurring letters and you say that Pete's in his kek, Pete's in his kek. Never forget that. Let's see, what else is there to discuss here? I've discussed everything that I could recommend in regards to finding yourself some kind of a place to start when you're looking for more meaning in life, and looking for why would finding meaning in life matter? Because the way I see it is, it matters when you find a way to make it matter. Then, knowing what to do and actually doing it become a lot easier. See, a lot of people think they know what they want. Let's use this as an example. A lot of people think they want financial success, or they just want to be happy. You know, let's just use being happy as an example. You think, well, what makes you happy? A lot of people don't know what makes them happy, and even if they do, they don't know why it makes them happy. So you can't really go about pursuing that. You can't really take a course of action if you don't know what to do. It seems simple enough, but then it becomes really stressful when you think, I don't know what to do. No one wants to be in a position where they don't know what to do. They always want to feel like what they're doing is a good thing to be doing. That's why I think, this is just my throwing out an opinion, I think this is why we have such an overabundance of media to interact with. You know, like fucking video games. This is a Nintendo 3DS. You know, we've got smartphones with social networking and all of those kind of things. You're always trying to distract yourself from the reality of life, and you're trying to distract yourself from your problems, because fundamentally you know that you're not living up to your full potential of doing everything that you could be doing to feel like you're fulfilling. It's like being useful and feeling like you're doing the right thing simultaneously. That's like the goal, right? But when you don't know how to achieve that goal, you put it off and you distract yourself. And people are really shit at telling themselves what to do. It's just an instinctive thing. You can't be bossed around. You can't tell someone what to do and make them do it. Even if they do, they'll create a lot of resistance in their head and eventually snap and not be doing it. The same thing happens when you try and boss yourself around. You say, oh, I have to have self-discipline, and it's like making a New Year's resolution. You know, you say you're gonna go to the gym every day and you really don't want to go to the gym, but you force yourself to do it. You can't force yourself to do anything. You can't boss yourself around. Jordan Peterson has a deeper understanding of psychology, and I could probably find a references to many of the papers that support this, but you can't boss yourself around. So fundamentally, what I learned from this is you can't boss yourself around. So the only way to get anything done is to actually enjoy doing it. So finding stuff that you enjoy doing makes it a lot easier to do it than forcing yourself to do it, which is why you end up playing games, you know, or why you end up masturbating, because it's, first of all, it's a distraction from the bigger issues, and second of all, because it's easier to do stuff that you enjoy doing. And when you enjoy doing stuff, it's very difficult to go and do stuff that you don't enjoy doing. Making yourself enjoy stuff is once again another situation where you're like, how do you make yourself enjoy stuff? You don't want to, you can't force yourself to enjoy forcing yourself to do something. It's just paradoxical. You can't force yourself into it. So you have to just very, very thoroughly think about it once again. If you don't like thinking, you won't like thinking about what it is that you see what I mean? You end up in a loop where there's a lot of suffering, but you have to suffer every now and again in the short term to achieve a more long-term fulfillment. I think I'm in a phase personally where I'm struggling to find what it is that I truly feel meaningfully engaged in doing. Like, making YouTube videos makes me feel meaningfully engaged, but I know on a more fundamental level that this isn't useful or as useful as it could be. And then I think to myself, well, how can I make my videos be more useful, more entertaining, and more well researched? How could I do that? I could do that by, once again, forcing myself to edit the videos and do more research, but then I'm forcing myself to do something I don't want to do, and then it leads me back into this cycle of negativity, which I want to try and avoid. The easiest way people try to avoid responsibility and negativity like this is with apathy or nihilism, where you say nothing matters because we're going to die at some point anyway. Everyone after us who's ever born is going to die at some point anyway. The Earth dies out, the galaxy dies out, the universe dies out, you know. In the end of everything, nothing matters. But personally, to you specifically, ignoring your family, friends, and offspring, if you have any, ignoring all of that, nothing matters to you when you're dead. So that relieves a huge amount of responsibility, because nothing you do matters, because nothing matters. You get rid of a lot of responsibility, but then you're left empty, thinking, hey, nothing matters, my life's meaningless, I don't know what to do anymore, because everything I do doesn't matter. That can lead you down the path of hedonism, though, where you start to think, nothing matters, so I might as well enjoy myself while I'm alive, you know, all this sex and drugs and stuff, seeking the ultimate pleasures in life, going out with a bang. And that, I guess it's fair enough. I can see why you'd want to achieve that and why you'd want to do that if you genuinely believe there are no negatives or positives in the universe. Things just are the way they are. It doesn't matter what you do or the consequences of it afterwards, because ultimately, once your personal own human experience is over, that's it. You died surrounded by hookers while you were completely fucked on drugs, and it was great, so it's like you can't complain. And once you're dead, you are dead, so if that's how you want to pursue it, do it. But a lot of people pursue this kind of nihilism and then complain that their life feels empty, they start to get depressed, and they just start really struggling to deal with life because of how meaningless it is. So then after a while of doing that, like, I listened to a lot of Zen philosophy and a lot of stuff that Alan Watts was saying, and it's like, if you listen into this, the logical conclusion of nihilism is that you should die, and the logical conclusion of believing that there is more meaning is that everything you do matters. So either one of those is kind of stressful. The least stressful one is apathy, but it just gets depressing. The more stressful one is saying that everything matters, and then it's like, well, why does everything matter? You can make the logical argument that it doesn't, but it just leads you to a point where you feel like shit, and I don't want to feel like shit, so what I'm trying to say is, I'm once again seeking meaning without just saying, oh yeah, God is what matters, because I genuinely don't think that there's any kind of like external kind of deity worth kind of meaning to life. There really doesn't feel like there is, and even if there is, it feels so much like there isn't that it doesn't matter if there would be. Now, that doesn't make, that sounds dumb, but you can hear me out on that. Like, it doesn't make me feel good when I think this is what a God would want, because there's just too many interpretations of God. The consistent interpretation of God is the whole kind of interpersonal human relations, the inner self, like dealing with your own inner self and dealing with the outer world, are both like very fundamental things across all religious studies. But even if you were to subscribe to like this kind of religious truth, it still doesn't give you enough purpose to survive, other than for the sake of doing it just because you don't want to die. Now, that brings you back to the whole evolutionary kind of, I only don't die because I've evolved to not want to die. Like, you put your hand on a hot stove, your hand will jump back because you've instinctively, reflexively got a desire not to be in pain. You see a fucking snake, you're instinctively like, whoa, fuck, get away from that, because you've got it like evolved into your brain that dying is bad. But the brain can logically assume that dying is good, because dying is the end to all future suffering. Dying is also the end to all future positives, but that doesn't matter, because if negatives don't matter, positives don't matter, nothing matters, and you just end up in a loop. Which is why it's very frustrating to find no kind of conclusive course of action. What do you do, and why do you do it? Your guess is as good as mine. People can throw ideas out, but it's all relative. It's very down to personal interpretation, and the fact that it is so relative is why you can't go to other people for answers like this. You can only find it within yourself. But even if you do, you start to think, well, if I found the answer within myself, that's just a subjective answer. But then you say, oh, okay, well, a subjective answer coming from myself could be an objective answer simply because I am the only experience that I can have. Therefore, everything that I find to be subjectively true is also objectively true. But that's like saying that you are the god of your own reality, and that your own reality only exists within your mind. Therefore, everything that you experience is true because that's how you perceive it to be. And I don't mean true as in, like, if you say that the speed of light is 1 second, the speed of light is like 1 mile an hour, that happens to be true just because that's how you think it in your reality. I mean, the stuff that you, the way that you interpret things is true as far as your brain can tell. So does it matter that it's true outside of that? Well, you know, it just leads you on to more stupid questions that don't help you take a course of action. A great way to think about this from Jordan Peterson is to try and do things as if you're a person looking after yourself, and like making the decisions based on what would be best for you, as if you were a person who knows you, not as if you are yourself. Now, what the fuck does that mean? Well, it's like the whole, you take away the, it makes it very easy for you to take away the personal decisions and make them an external person making decisions for you, even though that's still you. It just makes it easier to do. It's like you're controlling a character in a video game, or like you're a parent who's trying to choose the best course of action for their children. At this point, you would start to think, well, I don't know what's best for them, but you have a pretty good idea. You get into the whole ethics of it's not right to force your children to act and think in a certain way, but you do want the best for them, and if you have more experience than them, you generally do know what would be best for them in most situations. You can't always be right, but you can, I don't know, the parent thing is a bad example, I guess. Just look at it more like, if you weren't you, what would you tell yourself to do to get you into a better position? It just takes away a lot of the very immediate kind of, the immediate problems that you have with making a decision, because it makes you rely back onto just, it makes you rely on observation and logic rather than emotion. And acting on emotion, sure, it's great and it's easy, but a lot of the time you want to act on like logic. This applies to everything. Like, I've been talking for long enough now that my brain has just been completely frazzled and I can't remember what points I was trying to make. But either way, I'm just saying, like, I made some playlists. I'll be adding to them and taking away from them because I can't remember what's in them, but I'll probably be adding to them. If you've had any similar experiences to me, I would like to get your insight on this, because I think it's a very fascinating subject. The two big questions: what do we do and why? Like, what do we do? Why do we do it? What does it matter that that's what we do? And get an actual game plan, as a, not just saying, I want to make money. Well, how do I make money? Well, you do some work, you make a business, you steal some money. You know, there are a lot of options on how you get money, but which of those paths do you take? How do you know which path to take? Can you ever know which path to take? So another good question. You can't see into the future, but you can have a pretty good guess of which is going to be the most reliable. It might not be the most reliable path to take. You know, like stealing money, you know, for example, if you go rob a bank, high likelihood is, sure, you'll get some money, but you'll be arrested for it, or you'll be, you know, tackled in the bank, so that's not a great way to do it. Making a business, it's risky. Got a higher chance of getting more money, but you've also got a higher chance of getting no money and being in debt, owing people money, you know, if you take a loan out. Working, you know, you won't get much money. It's reliable. You could get fired. The job could be terrible. It could cause you suffering. It could be something you don't want to do. So then, is it really worth getting the money if you're doing something you don't want to do to get it? Then you get back to the whole kind of pursuit of happiness. You want your pursuit of happiness, you want your pursuit of money, you want your pursuit of health, you want your pursuit of everything. But you can't achieve all of that in a meaningful way if you're forcing yourself to do things that you don't want to do. So then how do you achieve everything you want while simultaneously doing things that you want to do? Once again, what do you do? But then why does it matter what you do? Very, very fundamental questions that I always get to every now and again in life. It's mostly around the summertime. It's mostly around the time when I eat bananas and drink lots of coffee and start to question everything. Is questioning everything a great path to be taking? I'd say it is, because if you ask the right questions, eventually you get the right answers. If you keep asking the same questions over and over again without getting anywhere, each time you try to answer it, you come up with new questions to ask, and eventually you might uncover something. That's the way I see it, at least. If I keep making videos where I'm asking questions, eventually someone might be able to answer it, or I might be able to ask a question in a certain way that it just clicks in my head, that I fully understand it at some point. The more research I do as well, that should help. I don't know if I call it research, if I'm just sat there watching stuff for my own entertainment. That's what it feels like half the time. Then every now and again I hear something in one of these videos where they just say something that just really fucking resonates with me and really ticks in my head, and I'm just like, shit, I never saw it that way. But does it help me? Does it help me progress anywhere? Not really. Doesn't help me. I feel like I want information to be more helpful. That's what I'm trying to do, essentially. I'm trying to make more accessible information for the people who need it. I have friends who make different types of, well, I used to have a friend who made different types of accessible information. What I'm trying to do is make the information that I find more accessible by asking questions and getting people to think about things in ways that they wouldn't have done before, because, like I said, the more perspectives you get, the better understanding you have of something, and as soon as you understand something, you're able to defeat it. If you have problems in life that you don't understand, you won't be able to defeat them until you understand them. That's something that's pretty consistent in all kinds of mythology, which is portrayed in like Hollywood films, in religious texts, in novels, and, you know, just everyday life, the same patterns occur. You never realize this, but the patterns that people have been experiencing for, you know, hundreds of thousands of years, based from our evolutionary experience, they're all the same everywhere. But in a very, very, very specific day-by-day, second-by-second example, it's very difficult to know how to apply that. Like, every single second of the day, how do you apply your knowledge in a way that's going to make you feel like what you're doing is meaningful and helping you achieve your goals and not feeling like life's worthless and nothing you do matters at the end of the day? So, anyway, thanks for watching. This has been a long ramble. I feel like you could have learned something from this, maybe. If you check out some of the videos, or if you have any things to recommend to me, I would love to check them out. I'm always looking to learn more, become insightful, and then just regurgitate what I've learned to the few people that watch this. I feel like if I do this for long enough, eventually I'll have such a good fundamental understanding that the following will just build itself up. And it's not that I need a following, or that I want a following, it's that if I'm actually uncovering anything that's worthwhile, I definitely want people to be aware of it, which is why I'm going out of my way to do this constantly, because I feel like I could finally find something that would be worth telling to people. So if I do achieve that, then that would probably help me with these kind of problems. That's another topic, though, selfishness. How important is the self versus the other people? I feel like helping other people would be fulfilling for me, but am I only doing it because I want self-fulfillment, or am I doing it because I care about the other people being fulfilled? I don't even know. Like, I actually don't even know. I want to say I'm doing it for both, but how can I know? It's like, it makes evolutionary sense that if you're in a tribe, you want your tribe to be more equipped. So if you know how to tie a stone onto a stick and make a weapon, you want to teach your tribe how to do it so that they are stronger, and then you as a unit are better. As humans are social creatures, so they want to better each other. I think that's where that instinctively comes from. If you know how to make a fire, you want to tell your tribesmen how to make a fire so that they can survive, you can survive, because they, you see what I mean? It's like you're trading it all off. Does it then fundamentally become selfish? It doesn't feel like it's selfish, but I think instinctively, even being altruistic is once again selfish. I don't know. That's just something I'm mulling over in my head. I can't tell, but I'll probably figure that out at some point after more research. I said thanks for watching it so many times now, but like, legitimately, this is the end of this video. I very much appreciate anyone who's watching. Recommend me some stuff. I'll check it out. Thanks for watching, you fucking dickheads.